Mr. Prakash Iyer, the former Managing Director and CEO of Infomedia India Limited, Prakash Iyer is currently the Managing Director, Kimberly Clark Lever, a man who shed dust and gained shine as he rolled on through his journey in hardcore selling. Mr. Iyer first became Executive Director, South India and Sri Lanka at PepsiCo, and later Regional Vice President at PepsiCo China. An alumnus of the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, passionate about cricket, Mr. Prakash Iyer is also a business coach and a writer. His first book titled The Habit of Winning has recently been published by Penguin. We have extreme pleasure, ladies and gentlemen, in welcoming a man who has worked with teams selling everything from soaps and colas to yellow pages and diapers, Mr. Prakash Iyer.
I request Mr. Prakash. Can you hear me at the back there? Oh, good. You know, the last time I asked this question, someone from the back said, "We can't hear you, but carry on anyways." So this is good to hear. Okay, good evening, everybody, and thank you very much for still being around for what is really the last session of this conclave. I must tell you that, you know, as I first touched this lectern, shock sa laga. Clearly, Major General's current has actually passed through this, and he's left a lot of it behind over here. So, you know, I think it was fascinating listening to him speak, and I must confess, I've been a big fan of, you know, of this entire idea of winning. And I often wonder, what is it that makes some people win? Why is it that some individuals, some teams manage to do a lot more and come out winning? And why is it that, in some cases, a lot of talent exists but doesn't actually end up winning? And really, this question stayed with me. And I remember there's a line from Vince Lombardi, an American football coach, who once said, "Winning is a habit. Unfortunately, so is losing." And it stayed with me to say, you know, it would be interesting to understand what makes some people win. And that's really what I'm going to try and share with you. This is not intended to be a major gyan session on how to get it right. Okay, that's not the intention. How many of you here want to have some fun at the end of the day? Say yay. Okay, so I think that's what we're going to try and do. We're going to have some fun. And I'm going to start with an old saying, which is, you know, if there's an elephant in the room, the first thing you must do is to introduce him to everybody. So I'm going to start by telling you a little bit about myself. I was born in a little town called Jaipur, and I grew up, yeah, how many from Jaipur? Someone there, obviously. I grew up dreaming, you know. When I was a little kid, I just wanted to fly a kite. Yeah? How many of you have ever flown a kite in your life? Okay, if you have, you would have discovered it's such a joy to be able to fly a kite. But you know what? The tough bit about flying a kite is getting started. Okay? The ability to get that kite to go off and stay in the sky is the tough bit. Once it's up there, anybody can fly the kite, okay? And very often what happens is many of us give up before we try. We want to fly a kite, but we try, and when we can't get it up, we give up. And then we live a life where we haven't discovered the joy of ever having flown a kite, okay? The truth is, it's very simple. If you just ask someone to help you, right, and help you to kind of hoist the kite, it becomes very, very easy. And I think it's true. What that kite is telling us is that's what life is all about. You know, don't be scared to try. And if you're in trouble, just ask for help. And chances are, somebody will actually help you to keep that kite going over there. And I must tell you that my fascination with kites stayed for the rest of my life. Because, you know, I soon discovered that if you want a kite to fly higher, what do? You pull it closer towards you. You pull it towards you and it flies higher. People are like that too, yeah? You want them to go higher, pull them towards you. Push them, and like the kite, the people will also come falling down. Okay? And I thought I had really learned a lot from kites until I saw this fabulous movie, which kind of dates me a little bit. It's called Namak Haram. Okay? Old 70s movie, Rajesh Khanna, Amitabh Bachchan. But you know, my hero in that movie was a role played by Raza Murad, who's a drunk poet and a kite seller. Okay? And you know, he's about to die. And when he's about to die, he tells his friend, "Jab main chala jaunga, to ye sare patange jo hain dukaan mein, sabko basti ke bachon mein baat dena, or you know, let them fly these kites." And then he adds this line, you know, "So that jab duniya ye nazara dekhegi, to unhe pata chal jayega ki upar walon ki door niche walon ke haathon mein hoti hai." Yeah. So it's something that stayed with me, and it's probably a useful lesson to have in management too. I also grew up being very fond of cricket. Anybody here who doesn't like cricket? Thank you very much for being here. Okay, I mean, a big fan of cricket, and I think there are a lot of lessons you can learn from cricket. And you'll probably find that, you know, this entire idea of what makes a captain suddenly turn a team into a winning combination, the pressures that people go through, the failures that people have to face. You know, no CEO in his life ever has to come home and tell his child, "You know what? I was supposed to do something today and I didn't do it, and because of me, my company lost." But think about it. You know, India needs some runs to win, and poor Tendulkar goes home having failed, or Dravid gets out for a zero, and his child looks up at him and says, you know, and crowds boo him and say, you know, "You didn't get it right." So I think it's lots to learn from cricket too. You know what? I started my career with this company. So finished school, B school, and went to work here. And the lesson that I want all of you to remember is, you know, when you finish from B school, your education doesn't end. It probably gets started. So an MBA is not a license to say you've become ruler of the world. It's a license to say you can now start learning. People will allow you to learn. And you know, Unilever is one of the better schools going around. But I must tell you this, you know, when I joined them, I was delighted. And I was like really looking forward to my first day at work. And you know, I was hoping that this is what I would do on my first day. Yeah. Just imagine what work could be to help, you know, find out how Zeenat Aman, you know, really uses Lux and says, "This is the secret of my beauty." And I was looking forward to going to work and then, you know, changing strategy and deciding what advertising would be all about. And guess what? This is where they sent me. Yeah? They sent me off to a little town in India and said, you know, "Go and sell soap here. Understand what makes consumers part with hard-earned money to buy our products. And when you do that, you'll understand what this business is all about." And that's a lesson I haven't forgotten. And it's a lesson that I think all of us must remember. Because really, business does not happen inside boardrooms. It does not happen inside office cubicles. It happens out there, on the streets. And I think all of you, and I think, you know, having spoken to some of the people over here, it's delightful to know that you come from small town India, from the real India, which is the future of this country. Indore might be the best as far as our future goes, but I'm confident that it's really these small towns where our future will actually get built. You know, from there, I went to work for a company where I think I had the most fun that you can have with your clothes on. Yeah, it's a company called Pepsi. Great place to be. And, you know, we were this young company, you know, coming out of nowhere in the US, taking on the world's largest brand, okay? We were the small guys, and we thought we were winning at that time. Not sure what the score is right now. I'm guessing we're still winning. But, you know, we were taking on this company and saying, "Guys, go for it." And I think it was a great example of what passion can do to actually win in business. And at Pepsi, this was really great. You know, we were a small, this was really the years of the Cola Wars, right? So we were the small company taking on the world's most expensive brand. Young, passionate people taking on big budgets. A startup company taking on, you know, a company which had acquired the largest bottler in this country. It was the classic war. Pepsi versus, I forget the name of that company, but yeah. Yeah, we'll figure that one out. It's a four-letter word. That much I remember. Okay. And then, I don't know how many of you are fond of C.K. Prahlad, and you know, he's written some fabulous books, and he's got this great story on the fortune at the bottom of the pyramid. And that's a great book for an Indian, in an Indian context. And I really fell in love with this whole idea of the bottom of the pyramid, which is where I work right now. We sell diapers, yeah? And trust me, you don't get more bottoms than that anywhere in any other business, okay? So that's really what we do. And you know, somewhere along the way, something else happened. A book. And the reason I want to share this with you is really this, that, you know, at the end of the day, it's important to nurture your dream, okay? it's important to not lose sight of that little dream that keeps you excited. Because at the end of the day, it's unlikely, you know, when you're sitting on that rocking chair in the winter of your life, it's unlikely that you will ask yourself, "Acha, meri gaadi kaun si thi?" Or, you know, "Mere card pe kya likha tha?" Or, you know, "Wo ghar kitna square foot ka hai?" Right? I don't think those are things you'll worry about. You'll really worry about those dreams that you actually nurtured and saw coming true. And I think that's an important one to remember, that never mind what you do from here on, and I'm sure work will demand that you do lots of things, but remember, don't lose sight of your dreams, okay? And really what I want to do today is to share some of these lessons with you on what it means to have the habit of winning, and what it can do and what you can do. And to understand that philosophy, I want to start with a simple story. It's a story of this statue in Florence, Italy. It's a statue of David, okay? And there's people who go to Florence and see this come back, you know, hugely impressed. They say, "Wow, what a statue, what a piece of work." They probably don't come back knowing the story behind the sculpting of David. The story goes that there was this large slab of marble, single piece, 20 feet long. And, you know, those guys wanted someone to make something out of it, and they showed it to several artists, and all of them saw that piece of marble and said, "It's flawed. Kuch gadbad hai. Something is wrong with this." And they refused to work on it. And for many years, that piece of marble was seen as, you know, really one long piece, but flawed. Something's wrong with it. Can't really do much with it. And it's around this time that young Michelangelo took on the task of saying, "Let me try and make something out of it." Okay? And he took on this piece of marble, took it to his workshop, and started working on it. And, you know, went away banging on it, hammers, chisels, all of that. And a little kid apparently came to his workshop, heard the noise, and said, "What are you doing?" And Michelangelo said, you know, looked at him, smiled, and he says, "You know, why are you banging that marble so hard?" And he said, "You know, young man, there's an angel inside, and I'm trying to help set it free." Okay? And if you think about it, that's true for all of us. I think there's a winner inside each of us. There's a leader inside each of us. The problem is there are these little bits of marble, little extra bits that need to be chiseled, taken away for that winner to actually emerge and come out into this world. And what I've tried to do is to say that, you know, instead of using hammers and chisels and that strong left hand, you know, there could be other ways of doing it, which is to tell stories. And if you tell stories, you'll probably find that you can use stories to actually remove some of those unwanted pieces and allow that leader to emerge. Because the truth is, we are all leaders. You know, some of us might lead small teams, some of us might lead organizations, some people lead armies, some people lead countries, but, you know, eventually all of us lead a life, our own, okay? And we are responsible for that life. And I think it's an important one to try and ensure that, look, there is that winner inside. What can we now do to actually help him set that man free? So what I want to do is to start with that ultimate symbol of achievement, okay? The highest peak in the world, Mount Everest, okay? Now, it's an interesting one, you know, and let me ask you a question. If two people want to climb that mountain, what's the most important thing they would need? And, you know, typical answers would be they would need, let's say, equipment. So you need oxygen cylinders, you know, good masks, you need shoes, you need protective clothing. What else do you need? You probably need training, you know, and therefore you have the famous, the real IIM, which is the Indian Institute of Mountaineering. You know, so you've got to learn something about how to climb a hill. You need that too. What else do you need? You probably need favorable weather conditions because, you know, if the weather is against you, you can't do much. But guess what? You know what you really need? If you want to climb a mountain, the most important thing you need is? You need a mountain, yeah? So, we need a goal. You need that mountain to climb. The problem with most of us is we go about our lives without that mountain, without that goal, and then we complain about our equipment. You know, mera wo PC slow hai. You know, not quick enough, or my goodness, I only have an iPhone 3, not the latest 4S, or, you know, we say we are not trained well enough, so we start worrying about training, or we say, you know, the weather is bad, environment is bad, what do I do, you know, we blame our luck, we blame circumstances. I came from a small school, small town, can't speak. So we find all those excuses. The truth is, find a mountain. Get yourself a goal. And once you do that, you'll suddenly find everything else changes for you. You'll find, you know, equipment doesn't matter. Whatever you have, you'll make the most of it. You'll find that training is available. You'll suddenly find people reaching out to you to share secrets, to tell you how to climb mountains. And suddenly, you'll find that the weather, you know, is incidental. And that's really what you need. You need a mountain. You need a goal to get started. So really, in business, it all starts with a vision. And I think it's important to ensure that you have that vision that's spelled out. And you know, in many companies, people believe that vision is this wonderful slogan that will appear behind the CEO's desk. Not true. Let me try and tell you a little story about what happened one day in Milan. You know, apparently a lady was walking the street, and she had these fashion, you know, shopping bags in her hand. She was whistling a tune to herself, walking along, sunny afternoon, when she hears this noise, clack, 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 clack. So she goes up to this man. She sees that's where the noise is coming from and says, "Excuse me, what are you doing?" He looks up, you know, almost with that disgust, wipes the sweat off his brow and says, "Can't you see? I'm breaking stones." So she goes a little further ahead, and guess what? The noise doesn't go away. So she can still hear the clack, 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 clack. So she kind of looks at that guy and she says, "Excuse me, what are you doing here?" He says, "Me? I'm helping to build the world's tallest cathedral." Yeah? Two people doing the same job. One person saw his role as breaking stones. Another man saw his role as building the world's tallest cathedral. Now, I think that makes a huge difference. And I think the question to ask yourself is, you know, if you work for an organization, when you start going to work, what do you see your role as? Do you see yourself as breaking stones, or do you see yourself as helping to build the world's tallest cathedral? You know, you might be running a great customer service business, but what does that lady who answers the telephone in your office, what does she see her role as? What does a salesman who's selling your product, what does he see his role as? You know, it's tempting to believe that, you know, each of these guys don't necessarily share that grand vision. And the great guys have figured that if you want something to happen, share that vision. And I must tell you that at Pepsi, for example, we had a leader called Suman Sinha, who really made people believe that the reason for our existence was to kill the other guy. Yeah. So if you ask the salesman, and we had a lot of these guys who would drive trucks, and you know, some of them became famous. One of those Sardars actually appeared in a film with Sachin Tendulkar for Pepsi. And if you ask one of those people, you know, "What do you do?" I don't think he would say, "Main Pepsi bechta hoon." He'd probably say, "Main Coke ki..." Well, sorry, can't say the rest of it. So, you know, that's what he'd probably do. That's the kind of stuff that makes these people special. Look at this guy, John F. Kennedy, American president. He had this grand dream. He wanted to put an American on the moon and bring him back alive. Story goes that on one of his regular trips, he was out to try and review the progress that they were making at NASA. So he was trying to figure out what's happening, where they were. And as he was walking the corridors of that space center near Florida, he saw a janitor, a woman, you know, who was ostensibly sweeping the floor that time, and she quickly pushed the broom behind and, you know, stood straight. And he asked her, you know, smiled, and he says, "What do you do here?" You know what the lady said? She said, "I'm helping America put a man on the moon." And I think it's this ability to share a vision with a larger group, with larger people, that makes leaders truly special, that makes teams suddenly believe that they can do a hell of a lot more. I now want to tell you the story of a man called Carly Takax. Okay? I'm not sure if any of you have heard of him, but it's a story that I think you must hear. Takax was a soldier, a soldier in the Hungarian army. Okay? He was a sergeant, actually. And apart from that, he was also the country's best pistol shooter. In fact, one of the world's best pistol shooters. He'd won the world championship, and now we're talking about the year 1938. Takax is 28 years old and widely tipped to win the shooting gold in the upcoming Tokyo Olympics, which is 1930. Guess what happens? In one of those regular army training routines, Takax throws a grenade. But unfortunately, the grenade explodes in his hand before it leaves his hand. And it just rips off his right arm from his shoulder. Okay, that arm, which was potentially a gold medal winning arm, was gone. The arm which was, you know, really the world's best shooting hand was gone. Tuckax was in hospital. Clearly his dreams had come shattering down. He was completely, you know, obviously beaten. And you know, most people at this time would have probably said, why me? You know, why does God pick on me for this? You know, why would they do this to me? And you know, you'd understand if this man then forgot about all of this and became a recluse, and you know, no one heard of him again after that. But Tuckax was made of sterner stuff. Within 30 days of being in hospital, he said, you know what, this is getting boring. What do I do? You know, and he said, look, what can I do? I still have, you know, I've lost my hand, but let me forget about it. Let me forget about what I don't have. Let me focus on what I have. I still have the desire to actually win a gold. I still have the ambition. I still have the determination. I'm still the same guy. And let me do something about it. So on the 30th day from hospital, he goes out into a shooting range and starts shooting with his left hand. Okay? And that's an interesting one because, you know, he says a hand which could not even take a cup of coffee and put it to his lips without spilling it, suddenly gets trained to shoot. Okay? And, you know, 6 months later, there's a national shooting championship, and Tuckax goes there, and, you know, all those guys look at him and say, wow, you know, Carly, so nice of you to come here to see us shooting. And he says, I haven't come here to see you shoot. I've come to compete. Okay? So shooting with his left hand, Tuckax starts going back to shooting. To cut a long story short, two wars intervene, so the Olympics don't happen. And then in 1940, I think, or was it 38, the Olympics come to London, and Tuckax is chosen by Hungary to actually go and shoot for them. And it's an interesting sidelight that in the end of the Olympics, winner of the gold medal in the pistol shooting event was a man shooting with his left hand called Carly Tuckax. Yeah? So I think two or three key lessons that I think we should try and do to try and get Tuckax into our head. I know many of you here are saying, yeah, you know, if I was a shooter, I would also do the same thing, you know, but that's not it. It's about what would we do if we were in Tuckax's place. And I think first, focus on your strengths. Don't worry about what you don't have. Most of us, by the time we finish college, have a PhD in our weaknesses, okay? As little kids, we get told by our parents, you're sloppy, tu padhai nahi karta hai, tu ye nahi karta hai, tu wo nahi. You know, we become experts at what we are not good at. Good idea to forget all of it and focus on your strengths. Don't worry about what you don't have. Don't worry that you come from a, you know, that you didn't go to the English medium school. It doesn't matter. Focus on your strengths and you'll see the difference. Next, if you get knocked down, remember to stand up quickly. I think that's extremely important. Even more so in a context like an Indian environment where, you know, we are all very good at finding somebody who's not doing well and then crushing him further and destroying his self-worth, okay? Don't let that happen. I think what we should try and do is to say that if you get knocked down, as you sometime will, remember to stand up quickly. Tuckax, 30 days after losing his hand, was back on the shooting range. And third, most importantly, attitude matters more than skill. I think winning a gold medal is not about a shooting hand. It's not about what your hands do. It's about what your head does. Yeah? Winning a gold, you can always train another hand to shoot, but it's a lot more difficult to actually get the mind to be programmed differently. And I think it's great to get yourself the Tuckax mindset, which says, you know what, if I'm a winner, I'll do whatever it takes to ensure that I come out winning. And I want to tell you a little story about a Chinese bamboo. I don't know if you know this. This is an amazing tree. It takes about 5 years or so to rise to a height of about 80 feet. You know, that's like a decent 8-storied building over here. Actually, 10 stories if you live in Mumbai. Yeah, it's an amazing kind of tree. But here's the interesting story. It takes 5 years for this tree to become 80 foot tall. But for the first 4 years and 9 months, you see nothing, okay? You plant the seed, you water it, and for 4 years and 9 months, you just see a little squiggly little sapling coming out of the ground, right? All the work in that time is happening underground. The roots are being formed. All that major network of roots that will support an 80-foot-long tree is being formed at that stage. And then in 3 months, it just takes off and becomes 80 foot tall. Truth is, most of us live in an era of 2 minute noodles, instant coffee, and are not used to waiting for success. What do? Thoda pani dalo, thoda, you know, fertilizer dalo, and after 2 weeks, if you don't see anything, you pull it out and check. Are there any roots? Yeah. And yeah, chances are when you do that, you don't find it. I think it's many of us are potentially these Chinese bamboos, but we are not giving ourselves a chance to rise to that 80 foot height. We are in a hurry. We are very quick to try and check if there's something happening. Worse still, if after a few months we don't see anything happening, we say it must be the soil, it must be the seed, it must be my luck, and we stop watering the plant and let it go. Yeah? And I think even later in life, it's a good lesson to remember that nothing of significance will happen in a hurry. Okay? And I think as you know, many of you young people out here, when you start going out to work tomorrow, it'll be very tempting. You'll go to work, 6 months later, you'll say, promotion nahi mila, and you'll move on. And then 1 year later, you'll feel, you know what? I don't like the culture here. And then you'll go to another place, another way over there, you won't like something else. You'll keep moving from one place to another. Give yourself a chance to succeed. Most times, the person coming in the way of your success is actually you, yourself. So think of the Chinese bamboo tree, and remember, perseverance will pay eventually. Okay? Winning is hard work, takes a long time, but if you persevere, if you do what's right, you'll find that you'll get there. I think the other thing that you need to do at work is to find passion. Okay? And I know there are some people here, and I know, if you're in some businesses, you think passion is slightly more rampant, but it's great fun to see somebody who's enjoying his work. Okay? And I think it's extremely important to find passion, because suddenly passion becomes this magic ingredient, you know, which changes life. And I must tell you that I'd again go back to one of the companies I worked for, and you know, this is again, it wasn't a company, it was a culture. So if you worked for Pepsi, you could have any car which was blue, and you'd be shot dead if you were found owning a car which was red in color. Okay? That was the rule. Now, you started hating those guys, and that was what, you know, it was all fun and games, but that's what builds culture. I must tell you, you know, I used to get transferred several times, and one of our transfers reached Calcutta, and, you know, little kids going to school, after the first day in school, the son comes back home and says, you know what, Dad, bad news. Now, you know, if you have to move cities as often and find your children changing schools so quickly, you worry about it. So, you know, we sit the guy down and ask him, you know, after he settled down, taking his shoes off, and say, you know, what's the bad news? Tell us. He says, I'm in Red House. Yeah? That's what defined it for him. And I want to share another little story. So this was in Chennai, and you know, those guys in the Reds, they had their office in a building on the third floor of a commercial tower. And in those days, these companies would not lose an opportunity to put up their brand. So what they did was to put up a board outside the office which said, Coca-Cola, second floor. Below that, one young marketing kid, okay, no, probably a year out of business school, said, you know what, I see an opportunity there. And he said, let me go and put up this sign which tells them where Pepsi is. Okay? Now think about it. He didn't come and say, you know what, dear sir, I would like to please kindly approve. Because if he had asked for permission, I can bet my last rupee, we wouldn't have granted the permission. Because, you know, this has to then go to New York, get approved. You know, can you really do it? No. None of that. He just did what he thought was right. Because for him, that's what this company's culture was all about. So when you go out to work tomorrow, good lesson to remember. Find passion. Do what your passion tells you to do. And, you know, an important line. Don't ask for permission. If it goes wrong, you can always ask for forgiveness. Yeah. So, you know, so don't worry. Okay. I think success is partly about getting this Tuckax mindset. It's about passion. It's about patience. It's about hard work. But it's also about teams. Okay. And I want to tell you a little story about a guy called Randy Posh, who's no more, but was a great professor. And he tells this story of wanting to become a football player for his country. Okay, as a little kid, he had a dream of playing football. And he really looked forward to this first day of coaching in school, when the football coach would come. So here were all these kids running around, jumping, brand new kit, nice shoes. And finally, the coach arrives. You know, this big guy, big shoulders. He comes in, and the kids are jumping, really excited. And, you know, they come and then they say, okay, great, let's get started. Suddenly, the kids discover there's one problem. The coach is here, but there's no football. So, you know, one kid puts his hand up and says, excuse me, coach, where's the ball? So the coach says, yeah. He says, how many players on a football field? You know, small kids do their quick math, 11 times 2. They say, 22 players. He says, right. And how many footballs on a football field? One. She says, yes. So today, we're going to start by learning what the other 21 people will do on a football field. Because at any time, only one man has possession of the ball. Yeah? So, I think very often we all go to work wanting to be that one man with the football in our control. We all want to be the guy scoring the goal. We all want to stay. We are hoping that, you know, everybody's looking at us and saying, wow, such a good dribbler. What a good guy. We are constantly holding on to the football. Success in life is not about what you do when you have the ball. It's about how you behave when somebody else has the ball. And if you learn to help other people when they have the ball, you'll suddenly find that you are actually emerging as a winner. So good lesson to remember. Don't worry about trying to gain possession of the ball. Try and think of what you would do if you were one of the other 21 people on the football field. I must tell you a story about this guy who, you know, yeah, let's hear it for him. I mean, if there's one man who's taught this country to feel proud of itself, who's taught this country to say, you know what, we can do it, we can win, I think here's this guy who's actually done it for us. But to me, my favorite Sachin Tendulkar story is actually from a time gone by. Okay, this is really, for those of you who are cricket fans here, this goes back to his debut series, 1989, India versus Pakistan. First three test matches drawn. This is now the Sialkot test, okay? And it's a real green top wicket. And India batting in the second innings, staring at defeat. We are 38 for four, okay? And all the four top four batsmen back in the pavilion. At the non-striker's end is Navjot Singh Sidhu, who's the guy who's telling us the story. Now, some of you might argue that Sidhu can't be telling you a story, but, you know, stranger things happen. So, Sachin Tendulkar then comes out to bat. This little kid, you know, 16, curly hair, chubby cheeks, comes out to bat. And Waqar Yunus and Wasim Akram really letting it go, letting it rip on a green top wicket. And as it happens, pretty early in that innings, the ball hits Sachin through his helmet on his nose. Okay, and the guy starts bleeding. And Sidhu recalls looking at that sight, you know, and saying, you know what, I'm sure all the women watching cricket on television would have said, there must be a law to prevent, you know, young children from being exposed like this. And Tendulkar, you know, was standing over there, and Sidhu says, as I saw him, we had all heard so much about him, and I was worried that we'd have one more example of a talent just dying away because of this shot, because of getting hit like this. And several people had in the past, you know, found their careers going nowhere because of the impact that an injury can have. So Sidhu walked down to Tendulkar. Ali Irani, who was the physio, came running with his bags. And they told Sachin, you know what, Sachin? To retire, retire hurt, you can come back later. Because by then the wicket would have eased a bit and, you know, the bowlers would have got tired. And, you know, I want your confidence to be intact is what he was thinking to himself. And he says, you retire hurt. Tendulkar apparently looked back at Sidhu, you know, kind of did that and said, main khelega. Okay? And I think those two words actually help explain what made a great talent as a batsman become truly a genius. It's this attitude, main khelega, I'll fight, which tells you that there is someone special out there. And I think it's an attitude that we should all try and get to ourselves. Because think about it. If Tendulkar had retired hurt at that time, no one would have said anything. You know, you get hit, you retire hurt. Can't do much about it. But here he was saying, it's not about me, it's about my team. I need to stand there. I need to fight. I need to say, main khelega. He stood there. He scored a 50. Sidhu, I think, hit some 90 odd, and we actually saved that game. But I think it's those two words, main khelega, which is really the legacy that Tendulkar leaves behind for all of us. Because if we can internalize that and tell ourselves, you know what, never mind what happens to me, I can get knocked down, I'll be hit, I can fail, but I will fight. Main khelega. And if you can tell yourself, main khelega, you'll probably find, you know, winning becomes easy at the end of it all. I just want to end with a simple example of what winning teams are all about. And it's also to try and tell you that, you know, some of the best lessons in life don't come to us from classics and textbooks and classrooms. Yep. They come to us from real life, okay? And this is really what I want to do. And this is an example from what happened in the streets in Mumbai, the Dahi Handi. We've all seen it happen at some stage, perhaps, where, in a, you know, we try and recreate what Lord Krishna did to try and get the makhan. And you form this human pyramid to try and get to the pot which has money. What I want to do is to share with you five quick lessons on what the Dahi Handi can tell you about how to build winning teams. First, it takes all sorts to make a team. A mistake that we all make is to try and find people like ourselves. We feel very comfortable. Mere jaisa hi hoga, achha hoga. Completely untrue. Look for diversity. Look for people who are very different. Bring them together and you'll have a great team. The guys at the bottom of the pyramid are these strong, fat guys. And then you have the slightly more athletic guys. And then you have a little kid who has to climb on top. The people at the bottom can think, you know what, if they were all like us, we'd be a great team. Not true. Won't happen. Next, this is a recurring theme, and I think you heard it from the Major General earlier. Don't fear failure. Okay? You know what? Look at that. You try and form a pyramid, you'll fall. You'll fall, you'll get hurt. What does that mean? They don't then fall and say, I hereby decide that I shall now go fishing from next year. I will not do any more of this Dahi Handi. They don't do that. They just go back and say, you know what? If you fall, you get up. If you fall again, get back up. All it takes to succeed is to get back up one more time. And if you can do that, you'll find that, you know, nothing to fear, never fear failure. Third, I think it's a good lesson for those of you, and you know, you'll all become leaders later, and I like the idea of some of you coming here 20 years later and speaking. But remember this, okay? As you climb up, you may be the guy higher up having the better view and, you know, seeing the world, and the cameras will always catch you. But remember, there are shoulders that you're standing on, okay? So you may be higher up the organization, but never, never forget the shoulders that you stand on. Fourth, I think it's a good one to remember that, you know, these guys go around, and if you decide that I will only do what worked for the other guy. So if you are, let's say, the team from Parel and you're Parel Panthers, and you're, you know, you say, yar, let's do what the other guys do, right? If the other guys go and break the pot, that's the end of it. There is no other pot that's going to come over there. So if you decide you will only copy someone else, you will only go where somebody else has gone and hope to find success, it won't happen. You've got to chart your own course. You've got to decide what you want to do, and you'll find success out of it. And finally, of course, I love this site. It's not eventually about getting that pot. It's about enjoying the ride, okay? And I think these guys are a great example of that. Somebody's a dabba wala, somebody's a postman, someone's doing some other work. They don't care. On this day, they all wear those same t-shirts, they all have their names, you know, emblazoned across their chest. They feel proud and passionate to be out there, right? And I think it's symbolic that it's not about the destination, it's about learning to enjoy the journey. That's what will define, you know, what winning is all about for you. So really, that's all I have to say to you today. I think you've been a terrific audience. I just want to leave you with one last thought. I go back to Michelangelo, the guy who sculpted David, and he said, you know what? The greatest danger for most of us is not that our aim is too high and we miss it, but that it's too low and we reach it. Okay, so aim high, guys. Fly high. Keep winning. Thank you very much.
Inspiration, inspiration, and motivation. We have had a strong dose of determination, teamwork, focused approach. Like Krishna Bhagavan said in Gita, Vyavsaya Atmika Buddhi Eke Kuru Nandan. There's only one for determination. Or the teamwork approach, as he said, Parasparam Bhavyanta Shreya Paramahapsayat. If you do work together, you will progress together. So thanks a lot for this. And we are running out of time, so I'll have only one or two questions for each of them. Major General has kindly considered that he will be here for after the session. He'll be here for about 10-15 minutes to answer other questions from students. So if you have any questions right here, you can come down and ask him. And one more thing, he has said that his mail ID is raj_s_mehta12@yahoo.com. raj_s_mehta12@yahoo.com. So if you have any questions, you can mail him the questions. The question from Meenal Gondkar, a student of Mahakal Institute. Once I have heard from Sam Manekshaw, sir, that leaders are not made, but they are born as a leader. Is it true?
Hello. Young lady, thank you for asking that question. In fact, I was personally present when General Manekshaw made that statement in a lecture. And I wonder whether it is possible you might have heard him wrong. Because the known belief throughout the world is that leaders really are not born, but they are made. And they are made in the crucible of hard work, dedication, energy, determination, junoon, passion, just about everything that you've heard from sir, and to an extent by myself. There used to be an earlier myth that, and this probably happened at the times of kings and emperors, that some people were nobly born and therefore they were born to be kings and to be leaders. But we all realize the futility or the absurdity of that remark in today's reality, that such things don't really happen. To give you one example, I, as an army officer, do not belong to a political party and have no intention of belonging to one either. But look at Rahul Gandhi. He is from a royal lineage as of today. But the country is not going to accept him as a leader unless he proves his credentials. So simply to say that this boy is of noble pedigree, his grandfather and his father, etc., were in the power syndrome or the power circle of the country, and therefore he is an automatic prime minister, is, as Jeff Boycott would say, so much of rubbish. It's really not true. So I would suggest that if you wish to be leaders of tomorrow, please give up this notion that you have to be nobly born in order to be a leader. You really have to work pretty hard at it. Thank you.
Thank you. And Mr. Prakash also has kindly consented to be available for question answers from students. So thanks to him. And just one question was there. There was from girl that which is the failure you faced which comes to your mind and how you faced it?
With the time that we have, I can't really rattle off all the failures that I've had. I've had several failures. Several failures, you know. But you know what? Those weren't failures. Those were really, hey, I learned something and went on. You know, I must tell you, I was the youngest kid and I had an older brother. So, you know, you typically find he can ride a bicycle, you can't ride a bicycle. He can fly a kite, you can't fly a kite. He could do everything and I couldn't do. And I would try and I wouldn't get it right. But I guess you learn over there that, you know what, your time will come if you stay with it. And the trick is to ensure that you don't actually give up in a hurry. So trust me, if someone says he hasn't seen failure, is he, you know, doesn't happen. We all see failures, but most of the secret lies in converting that failure into a learning opportunity and trying to get better from there. And that's a great way to look at it, I think. So.
Thank you. I request the session chairman, Rakesh Jain, to come and propose vote of thanks. Thank
you. Namaskar. What a wonderful valedictory session with these two great speakers, both Mr. Iyer and Mr. Mehta. I would dedicate these one-liners for both these speakers. One for Mr. Iyer is in the words of Mr. Shiv Khera. The way you explained the habit of winning is winners don't do different things, they do things differently, and that is what makes them the habit of winning. And for General Mehta, I would like to give this one-liner from my famous poet Dushyant, who says, "Sirf hangama khada karna mera maksad nahi. Sirf hangama khada karna mera maksad nahi. Meri koshish hai ki ye surat badalni chahiye." Thank you so much. Thanks to the speakers and thanks to the audience. Thank you so much.
Just one thing before the close. We have had a pencil sketch artist, Mr. Tiwari. He has been sketching for all the speakers. And just the last of the thing, so he would like to present himself. So I'll just request him to come forward first. As a token of remembrance, I request Mr. N.L. Soni, Director, Indo Management Association, to present a memento to Mr. Prakash Iyer. And I request Mr. Vinay Gupta from Ranbaxy to come and present the memento to Major General Raj Mehta. Thank you, everyone, and we come to the conclusion of this 20th edition of Indore Management Association Convention Conclave, International Management Conclave. The only one word I have is sayonara, till we meet again. Thank you.